It's r2youtube.com. That's r2youtube.com, and tell them Velvet sent you. Oh yeah.
Hey, 3000.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, brother. Thanks for coming on today, man.
Thank you for having me, man. You know.
Awesome. Now, so you started training at the age of 16. You were living in Detroit when you were doing so. So tell me, how does a kid, 16 years old, Detroit, say, hey, I'm going to become a pro wrestler? How did you get to that point, man?
All right, growing up as a kid, that's all I ever wanted to do. It was wrestling, everything was wrestling. You know, when I was in high school, a buddy of mine, he had like a some local hotline number, whatever, you know, that talked like, you know, the dirt sheets and stuff like that, who's doing what and all this stuff. Kind of like, you know, the WCW. That 1-900-909-9900 deal back
then. Yeah.
So, you know, I got this thing, I'm listening to it, they're talking about stuff, and at the end, basically, it was some guys, he set up a voicemail, basically. And at the end, he would go over, like, things, I guess, like, fans would ask questions, and he'd give info for, and he left the info for Destroyer School of Pro Wrestling, the Canadian Destroyer School of Pro Wrestling.
There you go.
So I'm like, okay, cool. You know? And before that, you know, I actually, the only thing I ever knew before that was like the power plant, because I'd see the commercial on TV, WCW Power Plant. So, I mean, to me, that's the only wrestling school that existed on the planet, you know, because you didn't see stuff like that back then. So, I looked in the yellow pages of all places, and of course, I didn't find nothing. I'm sure now you'd probably find something. But yeah, so I took the information down. Called the number to the Canadian Destroyers School of Pro Wrestling, and I told him, you know, I'm 16 years old. He was like, well, you got to have, you know, parents' permission, this, that, the other. You can do a trial and all that. I had to beg my mother, I mean, beg my mother to sign this waiver so I could train. And I made a deal. I was like, look, because I had a little job working at, you know, Super Kmart at the time.
Oh.
So I said, look, I will give you my whole check, only if you just let me have what I need to pay for my training. You can have a whole check, please, anything. You know, so she signed the thing unwillingly, didn't want to do it, told me it was a bad idea, you know. But I'm glad she did. After, you know, I did my tryout thing, and that was brutal because I didn't know what to expect, you know.
Right.
I remember that day like it was yesterday, man. I remember that day. I remember we went to the mall for something, and I ate a Cinnabon and had a milkshake, man, because I didn't know what to expect.
Right.
So I go to, you know, an hour later, I go to the school to have my little tryout, and, of course, he ran me ragged. I get home. I'm throwing up. My head hurts. You know, my body was just aching. I mean, bad. I never felt pain like that in my life. But I didn't care. I said to myself, I don't care how much this hurts. I want to do this.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. For sure. Yeah. Now, so you trained with him, and obviously he whooped you into shape real good. You know, the way you're talking, he whooped you in. So how bad was it? Like, give me a one day of training with the Canadian Destroyer.
Oh, man. Okay. With a tryout, I did a bunch of, like, I mean, the trial was basically, he was trying to break me. You know, he was trying to get me to quit. Just make me, he wasn't even really showing me how to do stuff the proper way at the trial thing. He was just having me do stuff to try to get me to quit. He would just say, okay, hit the ropes. Didn't show me how to do this. Just hit the ropes. These are still cable. So I don't know what the hell I'm doing. I'm throwing myself into these steel cables, tearing myself up. But I didn't, and he said, keep going till I say stop. You know, and I mean, oh man. I went home. It looked like somebody, you know, took a whip to me and gave me like 20 lashes or something.
Oh no!
You know, yeah. But I mean, I'm glad that I hope that all schools do stuff like that. You know, because that'll definitely weed out the people who really want it, and against the people who just say, "Oh, I want to do this because you know, ooh, that's the thing to do right now.
Right, it looks cool. Right, yeah.
But, yeah, training wasn't easy, man, especially, you know, being a kid. And at the time, you know, when I started training in 99, and that's kind of when, you know, people stopped kayfabing a lot of stuff. So I went into training not really knowing it was working, kind of not really knowing, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and then I started training. My first couple times of training was before they had that, what was it, the NBC special with all the wrestlers with masks talking about the secrets of pro wrestling and all that.
Oh, yeah, that? Yeah.
So that, I'm like, wow, okay. You know, because I was only learning, you know, I didn't know any more than what I needed to know at the time, basically, right. You know. So all that was still, you know, new to me, you know, it was still opening up my eyes as I was in training, you know. So, I mean, it was definitely different compared to how wrestling is now. You just go on the internet, look up anything, and there it all is.
Right, yeah. Know? Yeah, so, that's for sure. Now, so yeah. Your debut match took place in 2000. You were about 18. Yeah. So about 2 years, right? So yeah. You're 18. It's your debut match. You know, I'm sure you did some ring work, you know, with practicing with the Destroyer and all that stuff. But so what's going through your head for your first time ever in the ring in a match?
Oh, man. I'm nervous as all get out. well, I mean, I had to be 18 to wrestle anyway, you know. I mean, there was times where they gave me opportunities. Hey, you could be in this battle royal, this, that, the other. But I ended up doing that because I didn't even have a car at the time. My mother was like, well, if we take you to that, you know, I'm not taking you to training, this, that, the other. But my debut match, I was, like, just super nervous, man. And my first match, I ended up wrestling Johnny Bravo, who's a referee for Impact Wrestling now.
Yeah, I know Johnny.
Yeah, and at this time, I never met this guy before.
Right.
You know, didn't know nothing about him. All that Doug, the Canadian Destroyer, was like, oh, yeah, you know, we got a lot of guys. He's probably going to eat you up, but the other ones are worse. But you'll be all right. You'll be all right. Just mess with him, you know? So, I mean, I'm like, oh, man, I don't know what to expect. And the only thing I can remember, you know, I remember sitting there putting on my wrist tape, like just shaking. My hands like just shaking like this, you know?
Right.
Just putting on the tape, you know? And I remember thinking as I'm out there, it's like, wow, I'm doing it. I'm actually doing it. Wow, I'm doing it, you know?
Right.
So, I mean, that was my helpful experience, man. And then so, Johnny, you know, Robert was mad cool, man. Thank you every time I see him.
Yeah, he is a cool dude. Definitely a cool dude. Yeah. So, you wrestled in Michigan for a little while after that. And then eventually you took off and you went down to Florida and you started training with Sika. Now, did you intend on going down there to train with him, or was it like it was kind of like it happened thing?
It just happened. All I knew was, I wrestled around here for about a year.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm thinking, you know, the guy, well, after, all right, the Canadian Destroyer, he passed away the next day after my first match.
Oh,
you
know? No.
So, yeah. Yeah. So, I wish I got to know him a lot better than like the other guys did, you know, I didn't know him as long as the other guys, but, a guy that I would train with, you know, I knew, and then I would ride with the trainer sometimes. His name was Primetime Tommy Johnson. Real good friend of mine, you know, took me under his wing, helped me out a lot. And he was trained by Adrian Street down in Pensacola, Florida.
Okay.
So he was talking about how Florida was when he trained down there and stuff like that. And we should go down there and stuff like that. And I'm just scratching my head. He's like, you know what? Shoot, man, yeah, let's do it. I'm, you know, I might as well just go down there. And the only thing I knew was that Adrian Street's in front of his school, he had like his own apartment building, and it was 10 bucks a night. That's the only thing I knew. I didn't know who I was going to meet, who I was going to wrestle for, who I was, you know, going to, you know, train with or learn more from. None of that. You know, all I knew was I was going to go down there, and I knew I had a place to stay for 10 bucks a night. That's all I knew.
So it was kind of like a gamble. It was a shot in the dark.
Big gamble. I saved up close to like $1,000 and just moved to Florida.
Holy smokes. So then how did you meet Sika then?
All right. Well, when we first got down there, of course we went, you know, we met Adrian Street and he took us to the apartments and everything like that and showed us around. And then, you know, Tommy hadn't been down there for a while, so we were both asking like who's in the area and stuff like that. And he was just to one of his assistant trainer guys named the Wild Thing, Danny Heichel.
Oh boy.
You know, he's still out there somewhere.
Right.
But he was telling us about the people in the area. He was saying you got the Samoans, you had the Armstrongs, you know, Bullet Bob Armstrong, Stephen Scott Armstrong. They were in Milton, Florida. And you had another guy named Bobby Dow who used to work with Secret that started his own thing. So we went to all of them. Within a week, we trained with all of them, And out of all the ones we went to, the best thing, you know, I saw, the most opportunity I saw was with, you know, with Seeker.
Yeah, for sure.
Luckily, you know, he liked me, you know. He took me under his wing, treated me like family, but something I really did not expect, you know. I even lived with him for a while, you know. Even lived with him for a while. And awesome guy, scared the mess out of me, you know. Never want to be on this guy's bad side.
I can only imagine.
His look in his face. But I mean, I had so much fun being down there with them, you know, and the whole, you know, small family and everything like that. And I was down there living and training with Seeker and wrestling for him. He would make me go to his, you know, his son's football games, like Roman Reigns. He used to make me film him and the Usos. They were all on the same football team in high school. He used to make me film their football games.
So that's cool.
They were in high school, you know.
Right.
You know, and training with, you know, Rikishi and Umaga and God rest his soul, and Rosie, God rest his soul. You know, awesome family, awesome people.
Right.
You know, and that's an experience you couldn't even pay for, man.
I can only imagine. I mean, and that kind of leads into this next question. I mean, the Seeker's family, you know, one of the most famous wrestling families of all time.
Yeah.
And you cannot deny their influence on professional wrestling. So, I mean, with that, give us one of the greatest pieces of advice that Seeker gave you.
Oh, man. I got so many stories, man. I don't even know how to say this because I don't know. Piece of advice. I mean, I remember, you know, other than just, you know, going to the school and training, I would, you know, I lived with him, so I would take him to his, you know, to the doctor's office for his checkups and all of that, and just the psychology and just the talking and talking about wrestling and learning so much from him. You know, I mean, I don't even know where to start. It's so much, man.
Yeah, that's awesome that you got to spend that kind of time with a man like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That really has to humble you. I mean, that would humble me for sure.
He would say to me, "Oh, kid, you know, I appreciate this." "Oh, no, no problem. No problem, Seeker. No problem. I'll take you you need to go to the doctor. No problem." Because, I mean, so much knowledge,
right.
You know, just riding with him, talking to him. It was great. Like I said, it's something that you cannot pay for, something you cannot put a price on. As far as advice, man, I don't know for what reason this pops in my mind. But we were leaving the matches one night, and he's like, "Come on, kid, drive, damn it, drive. You couldn't be a getaway, man. The yellow light means go faster. That means go faster." You know, just wild stuff like that. I don't know why that pops in my head, but I learned so much from him, man. Just on how, you know, psychology-wise, how things should be. I mean, it was great. It was great, you know. I hope
he's doing
well. I really would like to go down there and see him. I don't know if we'll be there anytime soon, man, but if I could right now, I would.
For sure. So, you know, a few years go by, you're down there, you're with Seeker, you're wrestling for him for a while, and then you get a tryout match with TNA, and eventually it leads to you getting signed. You know, what led to the tryout? Take us through, like, so you get a tryout and then they say, "Hey, we want to sign you," or how did that work out?
No, it didn't work out that way.
You only wish it was that easy?
Yeah, they didn't say, "Wow, man, you're amazing. Here you go. Here's a contract." No, not at all. Okay, so I spent about 2 years down there with Seeker, right? Then I moved up to Hazleton, Pennsylvania. Where Alpha was. He ran WXW.
Okay.
Hazleton, Allentown, you know, close to the, you know, the closer to Philly than the East Coast, you know, furthest east of Pennsylvania areas, you know, towns and stuff like that. And so I was up there with Alpha for maybe a year and a half or so. But, I mean, financially it was bad, man. If I'd have stayed there, I'd have been living under the rent, you know. Yeah. And I was wrestling around really good guys, you know, like Low Key, the Hit Squad, Slick Wagner Brown, Tommy Suede, I don't know, I can't think of the name. Ricky Vega. I mean, so many good people. Cliff Compton, yeah, Cliff Compton. He wrestled with the WWE, tagged with Snooker Jr.
Okay,
you know, the Deuce and Domino, you know. Yep. So Cliff Compton, I remember this when we were wrestling for, Gene Snitsky, he was there too, you know. So we were wrestling for Alpha. Matt Stryker, damn, I'm probably name every damn body, you know. but we were wrestling for Alpha, and I come back from a match. He's like, oh, man, I like your style, I like your stuff. So he gave me Bill Barron's information.
Yeah, yeah.
And at the time, Bill Barron's, he ran NWA Wildside, which was really hot, you know, independent company down south. You know, I believe Atlanta. I'm not too sure about that, but it was down south. And I'm like, okay, cool. Thanks, man. Yeah, I'll definitely send him some stuff. And this was before the YouTube, the Facebooks, right. The MySpace, the Instagrams, all of that, the Facebook, you know, yeah. Chat, all of, none of that existed. So right. To get your stuff to somebody, you still had to send out physical packages, you know, right. Put it in the mail. You know, so I sent Bill Barron's tapes and pictures and stuff like that, and waited about a week or so. Then I emailed him asking, you know, hello, Mr. Bill Barron's, everything, and tell him who I was and if he got my, my package that I sent him. And his only reply was yes, period. That was it. Mm. Nothing more. So I'm just thinking, like, okay, well, it was a shot in the dark, but I tried, you know.
Right.
So then I just kept on doing my thing. End up moving back to Michigan, you know, because I told you financially it was not good for me in Pennsylvania, man. I would have been, like I said, under the ring, behind the building, you know, in the box. But so I moved back to Michigan, and by then, Chris Sabin, Scott D'Amore, and these are guys I knew from when I started, because Scott D'Amore was one of the Canadian Destroyers, Doug Chevalier's first students, and I was his very last. You know, and I met Scott D'Amore at Doug's funeral, you know, after he passed. Okay. And so they had just gotten the door over there. And with me moving back to Michigan, I didn't, you know, so much has changed, you know, as far as promotions folding and new promotions popping up. A lot of new guys, new promoters. The only, you know, people I knew and only school that I knew of still that was running was Scott D'Amore's Can-Am Wrestling School over in Windsor, Canada.
Sir.
So I went over there, you know, and I knew Scott, you know, and I'm just thinking to myself, I'm going to build up enough courage. You know, I'm just gonna ask him, who would I need to talk to get the TNA? Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. So I show up at the school, and I'm talking to Scott and say, hey, can I, you know, talk to you in the office? And he's looking at me like I'm about to, you know, start complaining, or I don't know. But I just asked him straight up, you know, hey, Scott, you know, I know you and Saban are down there, and TNA and everything like that. I was just wondering who would be the best person to, you know, to talk to, you know, for a tryout or anything possible. And all he said was, oh, you need to talk to Bill Barron's. Yeah, he's the guy that does all that. It probably take forever and a day, but he's the guy you need to talk to. He handles all of that. Didn't even give me his information, nothing. So I just said, okay, I kind of know him. All right, thank you. So I went back home. I emailed Bill Barron's again. You know, this is about after a year or so since that I got a reply. Just yes.
Yes.
So I emailed him. I told him who I was again, and I sent him a tape, you know, about a year ago when I was, you know, up at Scott D'Amore School, and he told me you're the best person to contact, this, that, the other. And he emailed me back like, oh, okay, cool. You can come down on this date. Blew my mind. I was shocked.
Right.
I just stood there and looked at the screen in disbelief for a good while, you know? And I just put, okay, thank you. I'll definitely be there. But now, you know, I'm getting nervous. Now I'm like, wow, this is for real.
Right.
You know? Okay,
dreams
wow.
are about to come true, right?
Right. But you know, my whole attitude with the whole situation was, is At least I wouldn't think I'm going to go down there. I'm going to steal the show. I'm going to show them what I got. I'm the man. No. The only thing on my mind was at least saying to myself was, okay, cool. At least I could say I had a tryout with TNA Wrestling. At least I could say that much. That's the only thought I had in my head. Nothing more than that. I wasn't thinking about, you know, how I was going to go there and just, you know, own the place. None of that. I was just happy that it happened. At least I could say I had a tryout, and we'll see what happens from there. And so I get down there. I drove to Nashville. From here, 8 hours, you know.
Right.
I got there the day before, and I ran into Scott, you know, and Saban, and Burt Prentice. I met him for the first time that day. And come to find out the next day, because this is when they were still doing the weekly pay-per-views in Nashville Fairgrounds.
Okay.
The next day, it was me. It was a six-man tag. It was me and two big dudes from Texas. I never got their names. Two big dudes from Texas wrestling Elix Skipper, Chris Sabin, and Jerry Lynn. And I found this out the day before. So just hearing that, now I'm even more nervous. Like, what? I'm doing what now? Okay. So, I mean, I'm just definitely afraid the whole time down there. I think like, oh, my goodness. You know, I'm happy. I'm excited. This is cool. I'm glad to do it. But at the same time, I'm nervous because now I'm seeing this becoming something real other than just talk. And yeah, this is what I want to do. It's actually stuff is starting to happen.
Right.
So, have the match. You know, it went by super quick, like 3 minutes or something, 4 minutes or something. The match was fine, no problem. Glad to, you know, to be there. Told everybody thank you. Get back home. A week later, Bill Barons calls me and he says, hey, can you come down next week? I didn't have any money. I was broke as broke could be. I had no idea how I could do that, but I just said, yeah, I'll be there.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And, oh, man, I as soon as I got done, I called my mother if I could borrow money. I went to debt for a while because I drove down there 3 times straight from Detroit to Nashville, no pay, you know, because they kept calling me back. Because I guess they like me and everything like that. But, yeah, now here, how this is how the D-Ray thing happens. So now they call me back. Jeremy Borash calls me in the office. And this is before the day before the TV, the pay-per-view on a Wednesday night.
Yes, sir.
He said, yeah, you know, think of this is before a contract, too. Think of a new name, something 3000. Just let me know in an hour. And he goes back typing on his computer. And I actually shouted out, like, because I wrestled as Don Crisis. I said, well, what's wrong with Don Crisis? He just gave me a look and said, something 3,000 in an hour. That sounded so ridiculous to me. Something 3,000?
In an hour.
I mean, come on. Who has a name like that? That sounds like a robot, you know?
Right.
So I didn't even know where to start with that. I didn't like the idea at all. So I leave, and I'm just sitting there shaking my head. Raven walks over to me. What's going on, kid? And he's telling me, think it's the first street you live on, the last, you know, the first name of your dog or something. I got nowhere with that. So I have no idea where to start. I'm just stumped. Christopher Daniels walks up. Hey, what's going on? I told him, he told me to think of something 3,000. And I said it just like that because I felt like I was defeated.
Right.
And he just shouted out, D-Ray. Okay, good enough. So I walked over to the office, and I said to Jeremy Borash, D-Ray. All right, you're D-Ray 3000. Okay, cool. So that's how the name came about.
And that's ever since.
Yeah. And so I would always be in the back picking my hair. You know, I grew my hair out because I just wanted to be different. I didn't know what the hell I wanted to be, how I wanted. I just wanted to be something different, you know?
Sure. You got to do that.
Right, you know? So I would pick my hair out in the back before the matches. Always did that, you know? Even, you know, back when I was wrestling for Sika and stuff. And Dutch Mantel was like, what the hell are you doing? I'm picking my hair. Take that out there with you. Take that damn thing out there with you. Okay. And it was one big happy accident.
Right.
So now I'm walking out there with a pick and I'm not knowing what the hell I'm doing. You know, I'm just, only thing I could think of was I remember I used to watch Sanford and Son a lot as a kid, and it was a character on there named Woodrow. You know, and he was like the alcoholic, the husband of Esther or whatever.
Right.
So I'm doing my best Woodrow. I mean, in the attic, I see growing up on the corners. Right. I don't know how to do this. So here I go. Let me try it, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how that happened. And now they eventually started Impact. Because then they started paying me and bringing me in without a contract. But then they started Impact in Orlando.
Right.
And now by this time, I'm with Shark Boy. And me and Shark Boy are sitting at a table with Vince Russo going over some skit, you know, promo. We're about to go in the park and do all this stuff and things like that. And Johnny Fairplay walks over, and he's good friends with Shark Boy. And Johnny Fairplay's like, oh, man, D-Ray, oh, man, you're so over. Oh, man, I was reading the PW Insider, and they were talking about the WWE is looking at you and Monty Brown and da-da-da-da-da. And I'm just looking like, oh, okay, all right. Vince Russo leans in, and he looks at him and says, where'd you read this? He said, the PW Insider, I don't know if I'm saying it right, but one of the dirt sheets, PWI, the PW Insider, one of those.
Right.
And he gets up. He walks two tables over to where Jerry and Jeff Jarrett are sitting, and 30 minutes later, here comes one of the office guys with a generic contract.
You know? Wow.
Yeah, all for that. And now, and this is all before we go out. So our little promo thing we're about to do kind of got postponed for a moment because I got, you know, hauled off to one of the office guys.
Yeah, yeah.
And so now he's going, he's got the contract in front of me, and he's, you know, reading it over and stuff like that. And I'm just shaking my head, thinking to myself, because it turned into, I say this all the time, it turned, when he's talking to me, it turned into like, you know, on Charlie Brown, how the teacher's wah,
yeah,
wah,
oh
wah,
yeah,
wah,
wah, wah, wah.
Yeah, that's all I'm hearing, because in my head, I'm thinking, okay, I can sign this contract, or I can go off this rumor. I could sign this contract, or I could go off this rumor.
Right.
I could sign this contract that's real right in front of me, or I could go off of this rumor.
Right.
If I don't sign the contract, they're going to probably, you know, okay, well, there's the door. Thank you. Have a good day. And who knows what's going to happen after that. You know what? I'm going to sign this contract. And that's real right in front of me.
For
so
sure.
So that's what I did. I signed the thing, and that's how I ended up getting a job with TNA.
Well, you were there till
happy accident.
Right, you were there till what? Summer 2005, and then came back in 06 for Bound for Glory.
Yeah, Bound for Glory. It was a couple other times that they called me to come in, you know, but nothing happened. They brought me in a few times, and then scratched at the last minute to come back, and it was a lot of back and forth because they all right. Dusty Rhodes took over the book for a while, and that was my original contract. I was still in contract with them, but I'm, you know, I respect Dusty, God rest his soul, you know, and one of the greats. And I always was, you know, respectful and said hello to him, spoke with him. But I mean, and I get it. I don't have any, you know, harsh feelings towards this, but I mean,
right.
His vision of what TNA, what he wanted TNA to be, I guess I didn't fit into that. So the remainder of that contract, you know, I didn't need, you know, I was sitting at home.
Right.
You know, then they changed it to a committee and, you know, they called me and they, you know, they were, okay, we want to do this, plan on bringing you back, da, 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 da. Don't do anything. So like signing with somebody, whatever, we want to do something with you and the Shark maybe. They brought me in a couple of times, scratched last minute. Then they, what did they do? They go from a committee to who was running it then? Yeah. This is before Kurt Angle got involved like that. I guess Jeff got back into it and Dixie got more involved.
Right.
They brought me in for Bound for Glory. They told me then, you know, don't do anything. We're gonna be planning on doing something with you because the whole thing with me and the Shark was, you know, if you saw that, it was kind of like a, you know, we bumped each other's back, like, hey, like, where you been at, buddy? And
right.
We're gonna, you know, get back together and do something, but then that got scrapped because it was so much, so much change of guard to where I kind of got lost in a shuffle of things.
Yeah, man, that's what's kind of sucked about that company too is that a lot of bad stuff happened because of all the transitioning that happened. Now, you also made an appearance on SmackDown in 07. Yeah. And so did you notice a considerable difference from one company to the other as far as how things operated?
Big time, man. Big time. There's no comparison. It's apples to oranges, you know, yeah. Big time. I mean, I could say when I started with TNA, they had a lot of guys that were like already established, you know, names that, you know, you that just putting your name on a card, you're guaranteed a house. You know, you had the Ken Shamrock, you had the Raven, you had, you know, Jeff Jarrett, you know, I could go on and on and on and on. Dusty Rhodes was still wrestling when I was there, you know.
Right.
So you can go on and on, Shane Douglas, you know. And then it turned into more where they started signing a lot of hot indie guys and stuff like that. But just going to WWE, I mean, they had everything you could ever imagine. You don't have to go get anything. I remember I did an interview years ago after that, and it was like the heaven of wrestling. You know, everything is there. What you need is there. It was no comparison.
Yeah.
Night and day.
You know, like a well-oiled machine, basically. I mean, they had everything all worked out.
From what I saw, yes. Yeah. You know, well, I mean, it was a kind of a wrench in the plans that I was told, because the way that happened is right when my contract with TNA, actually before it was up, because I remember reading it, it says that it goes in the last 90 days, I have to option to renew if I want to. And that was up to me. You know, instead of them just being able to renew me without me, wanting to be there. But so I called Tommy Dreamer. You know, he was with WWE. He was talent relations at the time.
Right.
And, you know, I called him. I said, hey, Tommy, how you doing? Because I met him a few times before then after ECW folded and worked on shows with him. So we met. I kind of know him a little bit, you know. So I just was asking, hey, is there any interest in me there, you know? And he was going on and on about, you know, well, you know, I know who you are, like, you know, you work and everything. Then he stopped and said, are you under contract with anybody currently? I said, well, I'm in the last 10 days to stop. I can't talk to you. When that contract is up, call me right back. Okay. 91st day. I counted it down, man. 91st day. Called him, got a hold of him. He gave me a couple of dates like that. You know, to be extra talent, nothing happened. You know, I went there. I don't know because, I mean, the hair was huge and everything back then. So, I mean, they didn't use me at all, but, you know, they brought me in to be extra talent. Nothing happened. Then, the second time I was supposed to wrestle Simon Dean on a Velocity. Mm-hmm. And it got as far as to where we got the match worked out. The arena's getting filled up. We're ready to go, you know, 30 minutes out. I'm in my gear, ready to do this, right? They cut the match because he had to go wrestle Benoit, some angle he was doing with Chris Benoit. So they scrapped that. So I'm like, damn, you know, I was thinking like, man, that would have been something cool, you know?
Right, yeah, but, for sure.
Right, but then he eventually got the job as talent relations, you know, Simon Dean, Mike Gucci. And he called me to, all he said to me was like, yeah, I want to do something with you and MVP on SmackDown. Okay, cool. Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, yeah. You know? Let's do so this. I'm like,
yeah, I mean, that's more than just saying, hey, we want your extra talent. He's telling me we want you to do something with you on SmackDown. So right. I'm like, great, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah, sure, thank you, you know?
Right.
And so I get there. I'm saying hello to everybody and stuff like that. You know, the day goes on, so I start putting on my regular wrestling gear, you know, my regular stuff. Then some dude says, Dorian, the wardrobe, and I'm wardrobe. So I followed this guy to wardrobe, and there was a guy named Mr. Magic. I'm sure you heard of him before, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he does all the pop stuff for WWE at the time. Yes. So I'm over there with him, and he's like, okay, you're going to be the African champion, and you're going to – I'm just like, what? I had no idea none of this.
Right.
I was not told none of this.
Yeah.
You know? So he's going on and on and how I'm going to look, and he breaks out this one called Kane and Balls Mahoney are off to the side laughing at me, and they're playing with beads and stuff that I come to find out I had to wear. You know, oh, they, all the boys thought it was such a rib. They thought it was so hilarious, you know. But I ran into these guys and worked on a lot of shows with these guys from over the years to that point, you know.
Right, yeah.
So I'm just thinking like, oh, man, who – somebody is messing with me. But at the same time, like, you know what? I'm going to do this and make the best of it. Hell, it might turn into a job. Who knows?
Right, yeah,
you know,
for strange sure.
things have happened. Look what happened, how I got with TNA, you know?
Yeah, uh-huh, for things, sure, so. Absolutely.
So, that's how that came about. And then I didn't even know I had a name until I actually watched the tape like a week later. You know,
that you didn't know what your name was until you seen it?
They didn't tell me. They just gave me a spear, gave me a loincloth, and, you know, when it's time for the match, Michael Hayes said, okay, go. And that was it. You know, I didn't know I had a name until I actually watched the tape a week later.
Oh, wow, that's crazy. So yeah. You're currently working the indies now, which, you know.
Yeah, I'm still doing my thing.
You're doing your thing, making a little bit of money, trying to, right? And so is there something you think that the indies do a little bit better than the big guys? Well, I mean, we all know that the big guys pay good. We know that. But, I mean, yeah. obvious outside of that, is there something that they're doing that's a little bit better?
It's funny you ask me that because a guy I know who actually went to one of my matches not too long ago was like, oh, man, you guys – it looks like you guys' stuff is a lot more legit, you know, and he's a big sports fan, and the only thing I could think of to compare it to, I was like, well, that's kind of like, you know, college basketball to pros, you know, they play harder, you know, because they want it. They want to be there.
Right.
You know, the guys in the pros, it's not that they don't want to be there and they don't work hard, but, I mean, they got it now. They have it, you know. They have that big paycheck, you know, and things are paying off. The guys on the indies, they're hungry. They want to get there. They're willing to, you know, do pretty much whatever to do that and go wherever to do that. So
absolutely.
I mean, when you go to an indie event, I mean, you'll see more passion involved. You'll see more passion. The guys really putting their heart on the line. You know, I'm not to knock anybody in the big companies, not to say those guys don't do the same thing, but you definitely can see the difference when you're seeing these indie guys who are doing this because they want to do this. And they have a love for wrestling compared to going to a WWE event and seeing a couple guys that got signed out of college and are just there because they want the money and they got a good body.
Right, you know? Yeah. I could highly agree with that one for sure.
Big difference, you know. Yeah, but I'm not trying to disrespect anybody, but that's just the reality of it.
Right, for sure. That's absolutely. So besides the Fro Gun, who else on the indies should we have our eye on? What's a guy that you like to look? What is a guy we should look at? You know, and it doesn't have to be Michigan. It could be anywhere.
Guys that I know that are really good, hot talents that should definitely be getting looked at. You got guys like Atlas Hightower.
Oh, for sure.
He's a really good talent. You know, I've wrestled him a bunch of times, and he wants it. Another guy that's really hungry and looks like a Greek god. The Wahash Karam, you know, he's another good guy. It's a lot of talent. That's the thing. It is so much talent out there that have not been seen or people are just tapping into. And right now we're like on the cusp of another wrestling boom. You got AEW, you know, Ring of Honor's doing really good. You know, Impact is still doing their thing. And you know, WWE is, they're still there, of course. You know,
It's
pretty much kind of, they're on, you know, as far as popularity on the same level as the main guys, you know?
Yeah.
But it is so much untapped talent. Man, I can give you a list of guys, you know, you got Aaron O'Brien, you know, another really good, great talent.
For sure.
I can go out on so many names. We'll be doing this for like 4 or 5 hours, you know?
Yeah, for real.
There's a lot of great guys out there that don't have deals, you know.
Right, and that's for sure. I mean,
but at the same time, with AEW, you know, coming into the picture, that creates a lot of opportunity for a lot of guys. So, I hope, you know, that is super successful because it's only going to help everybody.
Right. Awesome. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I like a lot of those guys. And even like the indie scene in Michigan is amazing. You know, it's just like I really enjoy. I head down to Detroit and watch some XICW shows quite a bit.
XICW, one of the top companies.
I love DBA. Watch DBA start something on fire. It's always a good time. Yeah. So we're getting towards the end here. Before we get out of here, why don't you tell everybody, you know, like, you know, give them their booking info out there, put that out there. And any social media you want someone to, you know, maybe add you on or what have you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm always online. I'm always on social media. The one thing about it, I wish all this stuff existed when I started.
Amen, huh?
Because it's so much easier now. You can go have a match, help somebody film with your phone, put it online, right, and now you give it to the world.
Right. You know? Yeah. Well, someone like myself would have never had access to someone like you either. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. I just reached out to you and, you know, mm-hmm. kind of like, hey, you want to do this? And I what am I going to do? Send you a letter in the mail to TNA or something?
Back in the day, it'd be, you know, a lot of tape traders sending, you know, yeah. tapes here and there and swapping tapes and like, oh man, you got to check this out. And maybe some weird way end up with that dude's email, you know, right. and then hopefully getting some kind of contact from there, you know? But yeah, man, social media, you can hit me up on Facebook.com/DRay3K. You know, you can hit me up on the Twitter at @RighteousMaker1. You know, you can hit me up on Instagram, Defunct3000, you know. But, I mean, I'm on all of those, but I'm on Facebook more than everything okay. else.
Right on.
So Facebook.com/DRay3K. That's the Frogun page. You know, anybody want to hit me up, you can hit me up from there, and we can get to rapping and everything.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Well, hey, man, dude, I want to say thanks so much, you know, for taking the time out and, you know.
Thank you for letting me tell my story.
Right. Hell yeah, man. And then I know maybe one of these days we could, you know, if I see you at an event, we could sit down and rap for a while and one like face to face, man, for real. That'd be sweet.
I'm one of those guys that talk all day long. It's funny because I make this joke about myself. I'm always the last guy in the locker room getting dressed because I'm talking.
I'm the same way. So yeah. we make a perfect fit, bro. We can have our own show. 2 hours long. All right, yeah. buddy. Hey, thanks so much there, buddy. And good luck with everything you do, and we'll see you here shortly, man. Thank you. Have a good one, man.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We are the Death Threat Army. Vehicle City Villain Aaron O'Ryan.
Black Diamond Jack Price.
The Wild Child Jody Threat.
And weaponized Alex Weir. And you're watching Wrestling Rage live on Friday nights at 8 o'clock on YouTube.